In a special poll for this week, almost three quarters of voters say that Neil Kinnock is likely to be the next Prime Minister. So what kind of man is Neil Kinnock, and what sort of Prime Minister would he be? Ahead in the polls, Neil Kinnock now faces his toughest test. Can he convince the British public that he's got what it takes to be the next Prime Minister?
He has re-established the Labour Party as a credible and competent party, ready and prepared to take over the responsibilities of government. I believe he'll make a fine Prime Minister in charge of a capable and determined government.
We'll continue to attack him, because I think that he's inadequate. He's inadequate as a leader of the opposition, and he would be totally and utterly inadequate as Prime Minister.
Neil Kinnock has come through past storms of Tory ridicule to score a series of electoral victories. If last week's local elections had been the general election, this would now be the cabinet of a Kinnock government with a majority of more than 60.
Trade figures showing the second worst monthly balance of payments deficit in history must figure very substantially in an economic debate next week, and I think obviously everybody around this table also thinks that this is extremely serious. We urge
Neil Kinnock now leads a united and confident shadow cabinet team. The Labour leader believes that his management style is one of the things that qualifies him to replace Mrs. Thatcher.
Certainly I know I've got the capacity to lead the government and therefore the country as Prime Minister. I don't hector. If I've got a specific requirement of people, I ask them to do it, tell them to do it. If it's not done, then I want to know why, but I'm very rarely let down. And I think that's a much better way to try and run a democracy than to constantly strut up and down, biffing people with your handbag, metaphorically speaking, and give the impression that somehow that provides effective leadership.
Kinnock led his party's local election campaign.
Are you sure this is road safety now? Okay, come around here, lads.
Nationwide, Labour gained more than 300 seats, but stumbled badly in low poll tax areas in London.
Stick with me, Bib. I'll put you in pictures.
The result left the race for number 10 wide open, with attention focused on the two main leaders. To walk through this door as Prime Minister, Neil Kinnock will need more than a Conservative government in trouble. He will need to convince large numbers of fugitives from the centre parties and from the Conservatives that he has the qualifications and the stature to replace the domineering figure of Mrs. Thatcher. And it's here that the first element of doubt emerges in our specially commissioned poll. The good news for Neil Kinnock is that 73% of our sample believes that he's either very likely or quite likely to be the next Prime Minister, compared to only 21% who say he's unlikely to win the job. And 60% of our sample see him as a vote winner for Labour, against only 28% who say he isn't. The more worrying news is that about half our sample, 49%, believe he lacks the necessary experience to be Prime Minister, against 43% who believe he has it. And there's an uncertain response on his leadership qualities, with only 24% saying he's a decisive leader and the same number saying he's weak. I asked Neil Kinnock why the message about his leadership qualities was not getting through to some voters.
Well, I suppose it's something to do with the messengers. I know that it's a habit of Labour leaders to blame the press for everything, but I think it could fairly be said that for much of the press, not all of it by any means, there is, especially when the Tories are under pressure, a constant refuge in making attacks, lampooning, characterizing me, and that means that for a proportion of the people, it's not the majority, but the proportion of the people whose opinions help to determine the outcome of the elections, the impression they get of me is rather contradictory to the reality.
The Mandela concert at Wembley was the scene of a classic encounter between Neil Kinnock and his critics in the right-wing press. Celebrating the release of Nelson Mandela after 27 years in prison in South Africa, it was a night when Kinnock let his emotions show and ended up paying a public relations price.
Hello, Adil, how are you? All right, okay. That's fine. Nice to meet you. Very nice to meet you. Very, very nice.
Great.
How are you?
Backstage, the Mandelas and the Kinnocks embraced. For the Labour leader, it was a deeply satisfying moment. His commitment to Mandela's fight against apartheid is genuine and springs from the youthful idealism of his student days. At Wembley, he strengthened his bond with Mandela, who had pointedly refused to see Mrs. Thatcher on the same visit. The two leaders saluted the crowd. Kinnock raised his arms, and for a few moments, the fist was clenched. Menibstia.
Do not listen to anyone who says that you must give up the struggle against apartheid.
For a moment in the vast crowd, Neil Kinnock seemed to be reveling in what he believes is the birth of a new Britain.
They were here for the rock. They didn't know what the issue is. You see the response. Great.
What will these young people respond to you and to Labour when the time comes to vote the next time around?
Most certainly, because we shall give them a lead that is the mixture of idealism and realism that they understand. That's how they live their lives, and that's how they want to see this country governed.
But outside, a reporter told Kinnock that his clenched fist gesture was being criticised.
About the clenched fist salute. And,
by whom?
Certain various Tory MPs, you know.
Tell me who.
Well, Carlisle being one of them.
The first reporter was from Rupert Murdoch's Today newspaper. Then came a team from its stablemate, The Sun.
No. Millions of people in there. Millions of people
that
watched it. I saw you at the end there with your fist up, full support for the whole ANC movement.
Why didn't you ask that question first?
Huh?
I asked the first question, but that's what you came to ask. You got this thing about what you call a Black Power salute, yeah? Well, I tell you what, come here in May, come to the cup final, see a goal being scored, and you will see lots of people who score goals giving what you will call Black Power salute. I was at a party, it was a terrific celebration.
Expression of joy.
And it's a declaration of solidarity. And it's a lovely day to do it.
The reporters left Kinnock on friendly terms. But that morning's Sun front page was a lurid portrayal of Kinnock's behaviour at the concert.
Well, there was a certain sense of resignation because I knew exactly what the Sun and the Mail and one or two other newspapers were going to do. Those people who were there at the concert, including yourselves, and as the film will show, know very well that the representation of my arm raised as some kind of Black Power salute was a complete fiction. I didn't do that. I didn't do it in that way. I didn't do it for that purpose. And they all knew, even the people who wrote the stories and took the photographs, that wasn't the case.
But you did on that night become emotionally involved in what was going on. Was that actually the right thing to do?
I was overjoyed by the release of Nelson Mandela. I'd worked for it for the best part of 30 years in the way in which people could work for it. It was a great night, and there's no reason at all why I shouldn't enjoy it.
Stories about Kinnock's allegedly emotional behavior have appeared quite frequently in the press. One columnist who believes the Kinnock temperament is flawed is the News of the World's voice of reason, Woodrow Wyatt, a man who said that he is perhaps a bit in love with Mrs. Thatcher.
He is the eternal student. I mean, I gather that it's his 40th birthday. There was a cardboard cutout of Mrs. Thatcher, and all the guests were invited to throw sponges at it. Well, this is the sort of jolly student approach to politics, which is not deadly serious.
I think a very important thing is that Neil Kinnock is completely underrated, actually, underrated by his opponents and to some extent underrated by the public and certainly underrated by the press. He is a pretty tough and ruthless character who is not one to suffer opponents. He showed himself, I think, by his reforms of the Labour Party, to be a man who is quite shrewd in the way that he tackles his opponents, and he's isolated them. He has done more to isolate and destroy the extreme left in the Labour Party than any previous leader, and he's given Labour the biggest poll lead it's had for 20 years. I mean, these are attributes of a man who is far from the windbag he's normally painted as being.
Neil Kinnock's job application for Prime Minister now lists some notable achievements, above all the reform of his own party. A landmark was his slashing attack in 1985 on the militant tendency in Liverpool.
And you end in the grotesque chaos of a Labour council, hiring taxis to scuttle around the city, handing out redundancy notices to its own workers. I'm telling you, you can't play politics with people's jobs and with people's services.
The Labour Party is now less raucous, more disciplined. Before a meeting of the National Executive, Neil Kinnock briefs the press, while Tony Benn, an old opponent, heads for a side door. The left has seen its influence sharply reduced as Kinnock has taken the party towards the centre ground. An important Kinnock appointment was a former TV producer called Peter Mandelson, whom he's relied on to sharpen the party's image and campaigning skills.
What he's done is to say to people in the party, individual members of the party, if you want to win, you must act as a disciplined fighting force, because people will judge our ability to govern the country by how we behave in opposition. And therefore, every action, every statement, every choice we make, every discipline, every decision we take has got to be properly disciplined so that the electorate get an idea of the Labour Party, that we are fit and able to govern this country. And that has to go on permanently.
Neil Kinnock now wins most of the arguments in the National Executive. Debates no longer spill into public rows. Kinnock's executive has ditched unpopular policies like unilateral nuclear disarmament and is now working on a plan to reduce the trades union bloc vote at party conference. The number of opponents has steadily been whittled down.
I deliberately put the argument directly to them and said to them, you constantly tell me how much of a democratic socialist you are. I'll accept that on face value. I want to know how serious you are about achieving the objective of winning for the Labour Party and for the country. And if you're not serious, well, forget it. We'll just encounter each other in meetings. If you are serious, then welcome to the team.
Claire Short resigned from the Shadow Cabinet in a row on the Prevention of Terrorism Act. Kinnock, she said, was a bully.
Well, I think at that time, and one has to think back, that was the style. I'll tell you what to do, this is the way, do what you're told. Which I must say, since I was a little girl at school, I've never liked. And people in the Labour Party aren't that kind of people. I mean, Tories will take it, we won't. But nothing succeeds like success, and Neil's leadership is now so consolidated and we are doing so well that I think that phase is over and his whole style is more relaxed, more democratic, more respectful of people without being weak.
Last year's party conference demonstrated Kinnock's firm grip on his new style party. In serious business before the baby-kissing finale, the Kinnock package of moderate, even bland policies was voted through with none of the bloodletting of previous years. Kinnock's colleagues see it as a triumph for his tenacity.
He has given leadership to the Labour Party, which he took over in a rather difficult situation. Low in public esteem, low in self-confidence, clearly in need of adjusting its style, its organisation, its policies to new realities. I think he took over the reins of leadership and has shown in the course of carrying them out both courage and integrity, which entitle him, I think, to be regarded as a leader of a very high calibre.
Relaxing in North Wales, the Kinnock family can remember good moments and bad in his career as party leader. Even on his first day in the job, he was lampooned for tripping on the beach in Brighton and falling in a wave.
Sorry, it's not going to get me.
The real low point was after the 1987 election defeat. Labour plummeting in the polls, Neil Kinnock widely written off as a leader who had failed. The strong support of his Welsh constituency party helped Kinnock through it. And at last month's meeting of the Islwyn party, it was that black period that he talked about when he spoke of the recent death of a party member and former miner called Bill Jones.
There was a time in the middle of 1988 when Bill was very ill because of his dust and he had terrible difficulty breathing. But the BBC took it upon themselves to run a phone-in program on the Tuesday morning, which was usually not a program that favoured the Labour Party. And the intention was to pillory me without any prompting at all. Bill, despite all of the things that were wrong with him, phoned the BBC, got onto the phone-in program, and offered the kind of tribute to me that I heard in the car and really moved me very, very deeply. And anybody passing the car would have wondered, what's that fella doing sitting in the back of the car with tears streaming down his face?
Long-time political allies believe Kinnock's humanity, his fairness, and even his ordinariness are his best qualifications for the job of Prime Minister.
He's a human being. He's one of us. He's not something separate. And that's what a lot of the establishment don't like about him. He is, in quote, an ordinary sort of person. Comes from an ordinary background like we do, has ordinary family like we do, go to comprehensive schools like we do, use the National Health Service like we do. He is one of us, and that's a great quality.
In the South Wales Valley he comes from, the tale of Neil Kinnock's rise has long been the stuff of legend. In the town of Tredegar, he was born the son of a miner and a district nurse in a small terraced house near the local pit. As a boy, his world stretched little farther than the nearby village of Rumney.
I'm not from Rumney. I'm from Tredegar, over the hill there. But for years, I came through this town on my way to school. I chased the girls here, I played rugby and snooker here, I've sung and danced here, I've been to the chapels of Rumney and to the pubs as well. And I'm grateful to Rumney for all of those things. But most of all, I'm grateful to this town for this man, Idris Davis.
Kinnock is contributing to a television documentary about his favourite local poet, now dead. He delivers his lines with musical timing.
You sad bells of Rumney ring sweet and clear. Idris and the pigeons are coming. They are coming home. Bloody good pigeons. Bloody good pigeons. Eric, you're a genius.
I asked about the influence of this background on his public speaking.
I think that in this kind of area, and in Wales generally, I think, people are not afraid of words. And whilst they may, and it's a fault that I have, sometimes use too many, and nevertheless, in trying to convey an idea, you really want to ram home every nail. And I suppose that's the reason for speaking in the way that I do. I used to speak much better before I used notes.
How then do you feel about this rather cruel caricature which some English people sometimes apply to some Welsh people, namely the Welsh windbag?
Well, I suppose it shows a certain gift for alliteration amongst whoever invented it. I think that on occasions, and I know better than anyone else, I probably use more words to express something than I need to do. On other occasions, I can't be very terse.
In fact, Neil Kinnock scores well as a communicator in our This Week poll. 56% say he's good, against just 34% who say that he's confusing and long-winded.
Mr. Kinnock, doesn't the Prime Minister realise, Mr. Speaker, that councillors of all parties, including her own, deeply resent the way in which she is trying to blame them for that which is her fault? Why won't she just stand up and accept her own guilt?
Yeah. Kinnock has worked hard to sharpen his performances in his regular jousts with the Prime Minister at question time. But his critics, often Oxbridge educated, claim that he lacks the essential quality of incisiveness.
Well, first of all, he's got very little brain. He went to a grammar school He then got himself into Cardiff University. But it took him 4 years and 2 shots to get a pass degree, which is the lowest form of degree you can get in any university. So that didn't show some intellectual aptitude. I think he has a reluctance to study facts and documents and reports and inquiries. And if you're going to be prime minister, that stuff lands on your desk unremittingly, 24 hours a day. And if you can't master them, you flounder.
Now, your severest critics make a further point, which they say counts strongly against you, and that is, to put it simply, they claim that you don't have the intellectual qualifications for the job.
I don't know how you prove otherwise. I could nip off and write a thesis, I suppose. Or perhaps I could engage them in a discussion on some of the things that I most appreciate, the theatre, literature. But that would be conceding to their snobbery. And snobbery is the reverse of mercy. Quality of mercy is not strained, it blesseth him that gives and him that takes. And snobbery is the reverse of that. It poisons him that gives and him that takes. And again, it's part of the scenery, especially of British politics. It isn't something that I can be bothered by. I know my own qualities, I'm confident in them, and I employ them, and I think I employ them very successfully.
I've been through the intricacies of policy with them. I've been on visits around the country with them. I have discussed in broad outlying, in minute detail, every aspect pretty well of our economic policy. And I believe that he's got a very firm grasp of it. He has got, I think, a proper appreciation of the level at which he should operate, which is to give leadership, to be responsible for conducting the orchestra rather than seeking to play every individual instrument in it.
Still in opposition, Neil Kinnock and his team prepare an attack on the government's handling of the massive trade deficit.
I think this is a colossal error for them to try and maintain that something as serious as this should not be faced up and recognised to be as serious as it is.
A Kinnock government will be judged on how it handles the economy. And to win an election, Neil Kinnock will have to show that he and his colleagues have some convincing answers. Our poll results point to continuing public worries about Kinnock and the economy. 43% say the economy would suffer under Kinnock as Prime Minister, compared to 38% who say it would prosper. The Kinnock approach is based on a patient effort to rebuild Britain's manufacturing industry, with government playing the kind of encouraging and coordinating role that the Japanese government has always done. The accent is on responsibility. But critics say the Labour plan is vague and that Neil Kinnock has not helped to clarify it. During an interview with BBC Radio, Kinnock turned on presenter James Naughtie after repeated questions on what he would do about the economy. In an exchange that was never broadcast, Kinnock said, "I'm not going to be bloody kebab talking about what the alternatives are."
I didn't actually lose my temper. Anybody who's ever seen me lose my temper will know that that's the case. I don't do it very often. I certainly didn't do it then. But what happened is, Jim Naughtie happens to be a friend of mine. If he hadn't been a friend of mine, it probably wouldn't have happened. I went in to do an interview about the trade figures, which were horrendous. And Jim, quite fairly, kicked off saying, "What would you do about it?" So I told him. Then he asked again, so I told him again. 4 times he asked it, so eventually I said, "Hey, Jim, come on, let's get on to the main issue," and the rest is history. And I suppose I was irritated because of the awful damage being done to this economy, my country, our country, and all anybody was interested in doing it.